Hello, folks, and welcome here to the manse sitting room. This Sunday, we're having cafe church at St. Mary's Hall once again, and we don't have cameras down there, so we're going to be here for our online congregation. I'm privileged this weekend to have Abel and Hannah Carkett. Is that how you pronounce it?
Yeah.
They're visiting us from Birmingham, where they're helping people to be free from addictions and to find new life in Jesus. Abel and Hannah, it's wonderful to have you here. Can we pray as we begin our reflections and our conversation? Dear God, thank you for this season of the year when we see things changing all around us. Thank you that that transformation is a reflection of the even greater transformation that is stored up in your heart and in your promised coming kingdom, in which you long for us to take part. Lord, thank you for Abel and Hannah being with us. Thank you for the way that you have changed them both, and in changing them, you have also changed others. Lord God, use your word and their words at this time, in this time that we listen, to change us, we pray. Today's theme is transformation. Transformation is a fancy word for change. But transformation goes beyond more than mere change. It's about radical change. Transformation is change from the inside out. It's that transformation, that radical change that we want to talk about this morning. And the first passage in Scripture that we want to look at speaks of transformation. The passage is 1 Corinthians 5:17, and there Paul, writing to his friends in the church in Corinth, says this: "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here." The Greek word in the Bible for transformation is the word metamorpho, from which we get the English word metamorphosis. Do you know that word metamorphosis? You probably came across it in biology class. Metamorphosis is what happens to a caterpillar. A caterpillar metamorphosizes into a butterfly. The change that happens when we become Christian, when we become a follower of Jesus, is not the same as the metamorphosis that happens to a caterpillar becoming a butterfly. We don't get covered in a chrysalis when we become a Christian. We don't sprout wings and start flying among the flowers. Actually, we don't look much different when we become Christian, but we are changed. In God's eyes, we are changed as much as a caterpillar changes to become a butterfly. We experience an even more radical change than a caterpillar when we accept Christ into our lives. It's like what Paul says here in our verse in 1 Corinthians. If anyone is in Christ, if anyone really trusts in Jesus, it is like they are completely made new. What they used to be like, what they used to depend on, is dead and gone, he says, and everything is new. It's no wonder that we Christians symbolize the new life that we gain when we trust Jesus with baptism. The earliest baptisms were done in rivers. In Thailand, I had the privilege of baptizing people like that. Here's a photograph. People who trusted in Jesus would stand in the water. I would say, "I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." The person who was being baptized would go down under the water and then come up again. And what this symbolized was that the person was dead to their old way of living, and that they were rising to a new way of life, just as Jesus died and rose again. And they were saying by this symbolism that Jesus died and rose again for them. And they were saying that they had died to the old way of living, and from today that they want to live a new way with Jesus as Savior and Lord. In another place, Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. That is metamorphosis, transformation, radical change. That is what life in Jesus looks like. And all of us who trust in Jesus have a story to tell about how God has changed us and has been changing us and is changing us as we trust in Jesus. I'd like to introduce my friend again, who's going to tell you a story of how God has been changing him. This is Abel, who's going to speak to you. And Abel has a story to tell about how God has been changing him.
Hey guys, pleasure to be with you guys. As Mike said, myself, I'm Abel, and my wife, we're down here visiting. Thank you for having us. Thank you for allowing us to share of what God's doing in our lives, of what God's doing in the ministry that we're working in, and how the subject of change is applicable into our lives, and how God helps with that transformation, and how we metamorphose after knowing him as well. That's used correctly. But yeah, myself personally, I'll share a bit of testimony. So I was born in Ethiopia. That's East Africa for geographical references. I was born into extreme poverty. It was my mum, my grandmother, and my sister at the time. My father was in and out of our lives, which was very common for that sort of part of the world. And we lived in a mud hut. And we slept in one bed, head to toe, all three of us. And that was life, and that's what I knew. Until I was the age of 8 or so, my father reappeared into our lives for some long period than usual. And he had an idea that he wanted to go over to Kenya, and then from there into Canada to seek refugee asylum. And he thought, as taking a child with him, this would look favorably on his application. So I, being the younger of the two, he chose me, and I didn't have too much of a relationship with my father. And unceremoniously, we set off, not knowing too much myself, we set off to Kenya, and there we were taken in by a host family who was going to help us with our application process for all the documents required, and we were going to stay with them, and then from there, make our way to Canada. But somewhere along the process, my father must have got disillusioned with the whole process, and he went back to Ethiopia, leaving me with the family that had taken us in and that was hosting us. And they not wanting to send me back to Ethiopia, knowing the life that I'd come from and knowing the extreme poverty that I would be going back to, they adopted me and took me in as one of their own and loved me and gave me a new life. And with that came a whole lot of changes, one of them being just cultural changes in terms of the language that was spoken, in terms of the surrounding I was in. I didn't know any English. I didn't know anything apart from the life that I knew before coming there. And my father's work, now my adopted father's work, meant we had to travel every 3 years or so. So from Kenya, we moved to Belgium. And with that, I was really angry and I was really bitter, and you know, I was angry at my mother for giving me up, and I was angry at my father for leaving me, and I was angry because I didn't know the language or the people or the things that were going on around me. I didn't really have the maturity to process everything that was happening, so I became very closed off and very bitter and very, very very resentful and very pessimistic towards my outlook in life. And as I did this, I alienated myself from my family. I started staying after school a bit later and mixing with the wrong crowds. And I started drinking in parks and dabbling and that sort of stuff, smoking marijuana and stuff. And at first it was recreational. At first it was just a teenage boy being a teenage boy. But these things soon started to begin to spiral. I was absent from home and I was just doing my own thing. And at the age of 16 and 17, I left school and I came to England where my grandmother was to live with her and to stay with her. I'd grown up in a Christian home. My mother was a Christian. She told me about God and his love for me and what that meant. And, you know, we attended church, but it wasn't out of choice. I had to go. I was under her roof. I was in her house. And as far as she was concerned, she used to say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And she literally took that to heart. And we went to church. But I didn't have my own faith. I didn't have my own belief. I didn't have my own understanding of who Jesus was. I looked at Christianity as a moral crutch, and I looked at Christianity as something that weak people used as an excuse to remove themselves from the responsibilities of life almost. And then that was my view. So when I'd left and I went away from my family, I ran into the world. I ran into everything the world had to offer. I was determined to prove everyone wrong. I was determined to show everyone that I didn't need them. My mother for giving me up, that I didn't need her. My father for leaving me, that I didn't need him. My adopted parents for the way I viewed it, trying to help me. But I was so angry and twisted that I'd formed a wedge between us. So there was that separation that I didn't need them as well. So I ran into the world, worked jobs and everything, but I was empty. At the end of the day, I'd go home and I was empty and I didn't have purpose and meaning. And the drug side of it came back into my life and I became heavily addicted into drugs. At this time, I was smoking crack and heroin and I was going out a lot and my work life suffered, my health suffered, my appearance suffered. And no one wanted to be around me. And I lost the jobs that I had and I couldn't hold anything down. I ended up homeless. I lost my home and I was just wandering from place to place. I was a shell of a man. I was empty and I had no purpose or direction. And this went on for some time. And I was just, you know, I was lost. I was in real darkness. And one day I was, something transpired, an event took place and I knew I needed to get help. I knew that I couldn't carry on the way I was going and I would end up dead. I had people around me that had died. And God sent an angel and he told me about this wonderful place that was called Fucella. And I went there not knowing what to expect, not knowing what to receive, just wanting a change in my life. And not really even wanting a change, but just wanting to get away from what I was doing at the time. And when I got to this place, this ministry, this rehabilitation place, here was this God character again. And I was presented with him and I didn't know what to do. So I said, you know what? The life I'm living now is not worth living. Why don't I give this God guy a chance? Why don't I try this and see if this has anything for me? And I was reluctant at first, but slowly he was patient and kind with me. And it was time, as transformation and as change does, is through time. It's not a one-time thing. It's day by day, slowly, a shedding off the old and a putting on the new and a transforming of the mind and everything. And that's what happened. I met Jesus and He started changing my thought patterns. He started changing my habits. He started changing the desires of my heart. He started changing my wills and the things that I loved and the things that I wanted to steward my heart towards. And I looked at him and I used him as a compass and a gauge. And in doing so, my life transformed. My life is transforming still. It's not a finished process. It's an ongoing thing. And I'm a million miles different to the person I was. And that's all down to God. And that's the work of Jesus on the cross and what that means for my life and the forgiveness that that brings and the restoration that I have with my family now is thanks to him. My lovely wife that's with me now is thanks to him. The family that I've inherited is thanks to him. The reason I sit here and speak to you is thanks to him and the work that he's doing and has done in my life. And it's not been easy, but it's been worthwhile. Change is hard and change takes time. And, you know, to transform is a process. And, you know, with Christianity, we put it on. We put on Christianity. We choose Christ every day. We choose to transform. And it's a daily thing. And I'm finding that and I'm growing and I'm changing as I go along. And hopefully for 5 years from now, I'm a different man and I've transformed from the man I am now even. So I look forward to that. But praise be to God. Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to share with you. I love you guys.
As we listen to the next song, the song, Change My Heart, O Lord, let's consider the power of God that changed Abel and that is able to change us to be more like Jesus.
Change my heart, O God. Make it ever. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you. Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O
the changes that come about because of what Jesus does is something that changes us as an individual, but it is also something that God is making to happen in all the world around us. It's part of God's big movement. And as God changes us, he changes other people and the whole world around us. In the Gospels, Jesus had a special way of talking about this movement of changing the world that he said that he had come to usher in. It's what he calls the kingdom of God. Many of Jesus' parables, those stories that he told, were to help people to understand that kingdom and what it would look like. Our next passage is a parable that Jesus told about the kingdom. I think it's probably the shortest of Jesus' parables, and here it is. Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 30 kilograms of flour until it worked all through the dough. Jesus says the kingdom of God is like a woman. A woman, an agent of the kingdom. It's not just a man thing. Women play just as important a part in the kingdom of God as men do. The kingdom is like a woman, Jesus says. A woman who takes a huge amount of flour, not just one of those sacks of flour that we buy at the market, but 30 kilograms, 30 sacks of flour. The woman in the parable takes all that flour and she mixes in a little bit of yeast. Nowadays you buy yeast in little packets, but in Jesus' day you had to catch your own yeast. You had to go on a yeast hunt to make your bread. Yeast hunting is probably the easiest hunting that you can do, because yeast is everywhere. The women, or this woman, would hunt yeast by setting a trap for it. She would put flour and sugar and water out in a warm place, and the yeast would come and nibble on the water and the flour and the sugar, and the yeast would get stuck to that bait. And some people still hunt their own yeast. Bread made from homemade, home-hunted yeast is called sourdough bread. And I've got a friend named Nicola who makes the best kind of bread that is delicious. When you put even a little bit of yeast in a lot of flour like Jesus's woman did, the yeast starts to change. It changes all the flour around it. It makes the flour get spongy and it makes it grow. Until you can't tell the difference between the yeast and the flour that is in it. It gets so mixed up, and the yeast changes the flour. The flour doesn't change the yeast. It grows into a big mound. Then you put that whole big mound in a hot oven, and it makes the most fabulous sourdough bread. The thing about this kind of yeast, not the packet kind, is that you can't really see it. It's almost invisible. What you're seeing in a jar of this homemade yeast is the water and the flour and the sugar and what the yeast is doing to it. I think that's part of what Jesus was saying about the kingdom of God in this parable. We are like the yeast that God puts into the world. When God changes us, like we talked about before, his intention isn't just to change us, but his intention is to change the whole world and the world around us through us. And that is what God is doing through Abel and his wife Hannah, my niece. They work for a wonderful organization called Betel, and God is using them both to change others. Hannah's going to tell us what God is up to in their ministry and in her life. Let's listen.
Hello, everyone. Like Mike said, my name's Hannah. I'm Abel's wife, and I'm actually Mike's niece as well. And so Abel and I work for Betel in Birmingham, which is a residential recovery community, basically, for people with addiction problems largely, but also other people who suffer other life-controlling issues like homelessness and just basically anyone who wants to change their life. And unlike Abel, I came to Betel a very different way. So I've been there nearly 4.5 years now, and I went to Betel as an intern. I was only going to stay for 6 months, and I just wanted to, after I finish university, have some experience working with vulnerable people. But while I was there, God really changed my life. And there's a long story in between, but I'm still there now, serving and working with the community. So here is a picture of most of our Battelle Birmingham community from a recent wedding. And the way Battelle works is it's very community family orientated, and people come and they live in either a men's or a women's house, and they come for free and they work for their own recovery. So they then become part of one of our charitable businesses. We have gardening teams. There's some pictures here of some guys who are working on the gardening team, and also some guys working in the restoration shed. They restore furniture. We sell it in our shops. And it really gives people like a restored sense of dignity and a purpose for what they're doing day to day, which is something a lot of people who come from the backgrounds that they come from have lacked. You know, so that's one of the wonderful ways where they begin to build more confidence and learn who they are and learn what they're good at and what they're passionate about. So we, as well as the gardening and the restoration, we have a cafe, and people are trained to work in the kitchen, and cook the food and work out front. And that's another really wonderful thing to boost people's confidence. So I'm trying to paint a picture of you for the way Battelle works, but really at the heart of it is the Christian belief that Jesus can transform people and he can change lives, you know? And that's what I have seen since the day that I walked in the door and the day that I began living with the women, which I did so for 4 years. I've seen people come, and when they walk in through the door, they're broken, you know, and they don't know who they are, and they don't know what hope they have for their future, you know, and they've been, their lives and their character and their stories have been tainted by the things that have happened to them and the things that they've done, you know, and you see them come in. And by living with them day to day, I've seen people literally transform before my very eyes. And I just want to share a couple of stories with you of some friends of mine. So this is Lindsay, and she is still in Battelle. She's a very good friend of mine, and when she came to Battelle, she'd been a heroin addict for more than 10 years. She lived on the street. She has two beautiful kids, and she'd lost responsibility for them. They were living with her mum because she was homeless. And she, you know, not only that, but when she came, she was hard as nails, you know. She was very, you couldn't get close to her. She didn't trust anyone. She was very paranoid. And as she stayed at Battelle and experienced the love of God and learned to trust people and build healthy relationships, and as Jesus worked in her heart through those things, she has softened more. Like, I can't even tell you the difference between how she was and how she is now. And it is just the most beautiful thing, seeing how Jesus does that in people's lives. You know, and even as I saw that, you know, it changed me. And that's what we have to recognize, you know. I'm nobody special. I haven't got a big dramatic story, but as we allow Jesus, as we see what Jesus can do and allow him to do it in our lives, he uses us, you know. So now I've seen what Jesus offers, I've seen how he transforms, and I can share that with people. So when new people come in the door of Battelle, I can tell them the hope that they can have in him. And as I do that, and because I can do that with certainty because I've seen it, it changes them and it sinks into their hearts, and it takes time. And like Abel said when he shared his testimony, it's a day by day walking out, and it's a day by day allowing Jesus to impact our lives. But that verse, the yeast works through the dough, you know, and it starts with a little bit of our life, and it travels and it changes, you know. It goes into the deepest, darkest parts of our hearts, you know, the things that we think, oh, I'm always going to struggle with that, I'm always going to be like that, I'm never going to overcome that. He gets there, you know, and it's day by day, but that's what the power of Christ's love in us does, you know. So anyway, now Lindsay, so if we go to the next slide, this is her literally a couple of weeks ago with her kids. She's still in Battelle. Her kids in the next few months are going to be coming to live with her in Battelle. She is a wonderful mum. She's she's probably the softest person I know now. She's gentle, she's kind, she looks after other women as they come in, and that's all because of what Jesus has done in her life. Okay, so another story I'd like to share. This is my friend Jo. The picture on the left is her before she came to Patel. She was heavily into heroin and had been for a number of years. She also has a little daughter who's now 6 called Skye, and she'd lost her completely. Her parents had custody of her, and she came to Patel, and she stayed for a year, and she met Jesus while she was there. And she's left Patel now, but she is just about to buy a house for herself and her daughter Skye. She's working a full-time job, and if you look at the picture on the right, that's me with her last weekend, and she has light in her eyes. You know, she's a completely different person. She's a new creation because of what Jesus has done in her life, and she's doing so well. And so what I really just want to encourage you all is, if Jesus can use me in the lives of these women and in the lives of people in Patel, I'm nobody special, you know, but I'm allowing Jesus to work in my life, you know, and all we have to do, if we want him to use us, all we have to do is seek him, you know, and allow his power to be at work in us, because it works out. The same way it works through the whole batch of dough, it works through our whole lives, and there's an outward fruit. The fruit comes and it impacts the people around us, you know. And when these women come into Patel, I don't preach at them, and I don't have to force it in their face, and I don't have to speak. I'm just friends with them, you know. And as they learn how to build healthy, positive, genuine relationship, Jesus works in their lives, you know, and he uses me. It's him at work in me. It's no longer I who live, but it's Christ who lives in me. And his work in my life is what they see. And God uses that to show them that there's another way, and there's a hope for them, and there's a way that their life can be different to how it was before. So I just encourage you, you know, search your heart. See where you can ask Jesus, I need help in this area, Father. Work in this area of my life. Allow him to do that. Get closer to him, and he will use you to impact the people around you. Thank you.
Thank you, Hannah. Before we finish, let's listen to one more song. The song called We Seek Your Kingdom First. And let's consider where it is God would want us to pray for and work for transformation where we live and where we work.
Transform, revive, and heal. us, Lord, when we have not engaged,
failing to scribe your heart on history.
Finally, let's receive God's blessing. Brothers and sisters, may the transforming power of God work in our hearts and through us in our families, our neighbors, our community, and all over God's world. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest and remain with us all evermore. Amen. Thanks for joining us. You take care.